Mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Richard Wood with Z News.
Welcome, my friends, welcome. We will be live here with you for at least the next 30 minutes. If you're hearing this transmission, you are the resistance. Thank you for joining us for this, the 121st podcast edition of Z News, which is a compendium of information on business, finance, economics and social and political issues worldwide, reaching over 10,000 subscribers every Wednesday and Saturday. Parts of this publication are picked up by 60 different websites weekly, exposing our ideas to over 10 million investors a week. This show is devoted to serving the needs of those of you who get it and want to get through it. And if you're wondering if this is your cup of tea, thanks for stopping by, and may your continued surfing be safe and satisfying. But for those that are looking for information, you are in good company, and I know you are in one of two places. You are well along in awareness and in the middle of preparation and planning, or you are on your way to getting there. It is Wednesday, the 25th day of May, 2011. Coming up on the show today, we shared what we knew with Greece. Papering over the problem never works. And massive amounts of foreclosures on homes in the US. Firstly, in market news, we hope all of our appearances on Greek TV, radio, and in the press have helped the educational process and to allow the Greeks to identify who the real culprits are and what to do about it. It has just been over a year since this tragedy became reality, but we reported on Greece and Italy 10 years ago. They both bent the rules to enter the Eurozone. We knew then that Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan Chase were assisting them by creating credit default swaps. There were a few European journalists who reported on the issue, but the elitists control the media, and few noticed that Greece and Italy were beyond bogus. The events of the past year remind us of the onslaught of the credit crisis, which unfortunately is still with us. What finally brought about trouble for Greece and other Eurozone countries was the zero interest rate policy of the Fed and slightly higher rates by the EC. These policies encouraged speculation and caused problems that would never have happened otherwise. In addition, the stimulus measures by both banks were embarked upon to save the financial sectors, and in that process promote speculation by the people who caused these problems in the first place. That began with QE1 and Stimulus 1, which we now recognize as our inflation drivers. Wait until QE2 and Stimulus 2 appear next year. It will be very shocking. Just to show you what a loser lower rates are, just look at economic progress. There has been no recovery under either QE1 or QE2. Even 4.60% 30-year fixed-rate mortgages have not encouraged people to buy homes. They are either broke, or they don't know whether they will be employed 5 months or even 1 year from now. So how can they buy a house? Consumer spending is falling along with wages. The small gains you see are, for the most part, the result of higher inflation. Growth moved from the fourth quarter of 2010 of 3.1% to 1.8% in the first quarter of 2011. We had forecast 2 to 2.5% growth for 2011. There is little to show for a minimum of $1.8 trillion spent in QE2 and Stimulus 2. Without that, we probably would have been at a minus 2%. Just think about that. Trillions of dollars spent with little results. Obviously, such programs do not work very well. You would have thought the Fed would have found a better way after two such failures. They know what the solution is, but they won't put it into motion, and that is to purge the system and face deflationary depression. That will happen whether they like it or not. But in the meantime, the flip side is 10% inflation headed to 14% by year end, and another greater wave next year, and another in 2013. Unimpressive results is not the word for it. It has been a disaster, and the Fed keeps right on doing it. As a result of the discounting of QE3, we wonder what the stock market has in store for us. We would think that a correction would be in the future. If that is so, could that negatively affect the economy? Of course it could. All the good news coming, further stimulus by the Fed, will have been discounted. What does the Fed do for an encore? Create more money in credit? Probably. Does that mean hyperinflation? Of course it does. If the Fed stops, the game is over. We are also seeing fewer results from additional stimulus. It is called the law of diminishing returns. In the meantime, the dollar goes ever lower versus other currencies, but more importantly, versus gold and silver. If you can believe it, even though the Fed has provided financial flows and assisting speculative flows so Wall Street banking and hedge funds can glean mega profits, it still has not provided enough liquidity for additional GDP growth. Small and medium-sized businesses have been shut out. The latter participants do not play those games. It is the proprietary trading desks, hedge funds, and the remainder of the leveraged speculating community that takes advantage of the excess liquidity. And the Bernanke put of keeping bonds and stocks up artificially. The Fed and the others are sustaining this process. There are negatives for the Fed and their friends. Higher commodity and gold and silver prices. The Fed and the banks temporarily took care of that and haven't quite finished the latest short-term foray in that sector. There are still fears as well regarding Greek debt fears and their CDS or credit default swaps and those of other Eurozone members. They could still blow up in everyone's faces in a partial, if not total, default, which is very likely. Banks are on the wrong side of this trade as well. This is the bond trade not only with Greece but five other nations as well. In the final analysis, papering over the problem never works. The problems also reemerge with new additional problems. The combination of excessive speculation and liquidity and too big to fail is going to end badly, as it always has. Deleveraging will eventually rear its ugly head. As we said, Greece and others could cause extensive bond and CDS problems, and that is not only being reflected in lower euro, but in a higher Greek bond yields of 16.375% in their 10-year notes and 24.75% in 2-year yields. And Portugal, Ireland and Spain are not far behind. The socialists just lost their latest election in Spain in a big way, showing the public is fed up with the lies of government and the bankers. The euro is attempting to break $1.40 to the downside as a result of those election results and the Greek impasse. It is obvious that Greece cannot service its debt and reduce its deficit, and the other deficient nations are in the same boat. The CDS marketplace would be severely disrupted if there were a sovereign debt default. That fear of contagion could be seen in higher rates in Spain, some 0.30%, the highest upward move this year. Greece, Ireland, and Portugal have problems that can never be resolved, and Spain, Italy, and Belgium are not far behind. Spain is implementing austerity, but that means, like in recent weeks, millions have demonstrated in 72 Spanish cities. The 17 autonomous regions have doubled their debt in the last 2.5 years. The socialists just did not know when to stop. Now they are out of office. Spain is going down. There is no way they can sustain. That should bring the CDS situation front and center. It will also increase unemployment for those 18 to 35 to 40% or more. It is not surprising that half of the protesters were in that age group. Greek PM George Papandreou, who secretly promised Europe's elitist bankers that he would sell off or pledge Greek state assets, wants to sell stakes in Hellenic Telecommunications, Public Power Corp, Post Bank, the ports of Piraeus and Thessalonica, and their local water company, all supposedly worth $70 billion. The bankers, of course, say they are worth far less. They want to buy them for 10 to 20% of what they are worth. So, what else is new? The cabinet went along with the giveaway as expected, and without a whimper. The EU is demanding all the assets be sold off immediately, so the bankers can buy them as cheaply as possible. The threat by the bankers is, if you do not sell, and sell fast, for a pittance, then we won't fund loans of 42 billion over the next 2.5 to 3 years. If not funded, it would be reprofiled, another new euphemism for default and debt restructuring, or perhaps debt extension. Then there is the threat that the bankers, the ECB, European Central Bank for the Eurozone, would refuse to supply the Greek banking system with any further liquidity. They would then admit their new world of refilling would mean default. This would end with Greece leaving the Eurozone and the Euro in total default. The issuance of a new drachma at 50% of the value of the Euro, and perhaps even leaving the EU, the European Union. Jens Weidmann, the Bundesbank new president, said no compromise on monetary stability and a correction back to normality and a full separation between monetary and fiscal policy. It is obvious to us that in spite of debt of $620 billion, that Germany wants to cut Greece loose. The German voters said that in last month's elections. The Germans should have accepted default for 50 cents on the dollar offered by the Greeks a year ago. Even if the Greeks sold $50 billion in assets, it would be a drop in the bucket when they cannot possibly pay off the remainder of the debt ever. This shows you how derelict the bankers in sovereign countries were in allowing this debt to be accumulated. In addition, Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan Chase hid their problems via credit default swaps, and now these same banks and others want to loot the country. Tuesday, Jean-Claude Juncker, chair of the Eurozone Finance Ministers Committee, had to admit he lied about the secret meeting the bankers had concerning Greece. He is another who says Greece cannot pay its debt under its current debt burden. Both he and Lorenzo Bini Shmagi, member of the executive board of the European Central Bank, said that any partial or total default would put all of Europe and the EU in jeopardy. In fact, some of these apologists for banks, especially the Germans, have entertained having Germany control Greek budgets and collect taxes. That means you would have a financial SS running things not only in Greece, but also in Ireland and Portugal, and eventually in Belgium, Spain and Italy. It should be noted the ECB paid in capital $14 billion and they hold $183 billion in Greek debt. We would say the ECB is already insolvent. It could be the Ponzi scheme, much like that of the Feds, will soon come to an end. Some believe that a 50% markdown is in store for Greek debt. That could have worked a year ago, but not now. It is 2/3 or more of a write-down. We can just imagine Greece, Portugal, Ireland, Belgium, Spain and Italy recapitalizing the ECB. Forget it. That is why partial or full debt default are out of the question. Just to buy time, the ECB will kick the can down the road as long as they can. Those six nations in trouble should all go back to their currencies, default by at least two-thirds, and leave the euro. European bondholders with a 50% debt write-off are offside $1.2 trillion for Greek, Portuguese, and Irish debt. If we include Spain, Italy, and Belgium, the 50% write-off is $846 billion. That should easily destroy the ECB and the Eurozone. We predict that by October, changes will have to be made not only in the EU and Eurozone, but in the UK and US as well. The battle rages in the Eurozone, EU, UK, and in the US over overwhelming debt. The debts are all unpayable. This dance of debt could go on for 5 or 4 months. Even a temporary solution is not going to work. The debts are unpayable. Once the lending stops, the bottom falls out. The same is true in the US. They cannot raise interest rates, and neither can the UK and the Eurozone. And the issuance of money and credit can only lead to inflation and hyperinflation. The bankers and the politicians in the debtor countries have so enraged the public. And the public now knows what they are up to because of talk radio and the internet, that we don't believe there can be settlements. We'll see by the end of October, and perhaps much sooner. All one party or group has to say is forget it, we are out of here. And the entire system blows up. We have seen the extensive damage, as we predicted. It has been caused by one interest rate fits all, which led to a major misallocation of funds and malinvestment. Due to such low interest rates, massive debt was accumulated. The EU's answer is to usurp your sovereignty and turn the entire mess over to technocrats who will most certainly make matters worse. Political currencies like the euro do not work. It is an unnatural cultural instrument designed to bring people of differing cultures together as one. The order envisioned by European elitists is total amalgamation of all nations at every level. What the professionals, not included with the elitists, don't understand is that these illuminists want world government at any cost. The insiders in Europe have realized their plan did not work and that the six countries involved have to be cut loose and the remainder has to stay with the euro. Whether this can be accomplished remains to be seen, and we personally believe it is a lost cause. In this withdrawal process, bankers and others are going to be exposed, and the outcome will be jail time and forfeiture of ill-begotten gains. Over the past 1.5 years, we have witnessed a degenerative process in Greece and in other nations as well. The Greek president and his party does not have the votes to give away Greece's assets to European bankers, even though they promised to do so. Antonis Samaras, opposition leader, is not going to allow that to happen. The standoff could last 4 to 5 months. No Greek property, collateralization, and severe austerity are not acceptable. Opposition support will not be forthcoming. The formula proposed by the bankers is the same one used by the IMF to loot countries and keep them in perpetual servitude and poverty. Probably on orders from the bankers, the present government has made no effort to restart the economy. Mr. Samaras has called for renegotiation of the bailout deal before anything meaningful can get underway or proceed. He also knows 62% of the voting public is behind what he recommends, and that only 15% are against. That is why a referendum would solidify his position. If PM Papandreou promised the bankers he would sell off Greek assets, he should not have done that, because he doesn't have the power to do so. Worse yet, now Alexis Tsipras of the Left Coalition is calling for Mr. Papandreou's resignation. Tsipras said what Mr. Papandreou is doing is a crime against the Greek people. Professors and experts are pushing for a referendum because they say what the PM is going to do is illegal. Polls already showing that 62% of the electorate is against using Greek national assets as collateral. 15% are for, which means 23% is undecided. The PM does not have a majority in Congress, and he cannot win a referendum for the terrorist bankers. These problems could last for months. In the final analysis, they will be a partial bankruptcy that could last a year or two. Ultimately, such an arrangement won't work. We are very proud of Mrs. Theodakaris and Samaras as they save Greece from the tyranny of the bankers. As an addendum, Italy has public debt of 120% of GDP and compromised 17% of the euro's total GDP. Spain is 12%. In Greece, Ireland, and Portugal, 6%. If Italy or Spain goes bankrupt, the euro is dead. Italy has had a slow economy for 10 years. The top 91 European banks carry $144 billion in Italian debt, or quadruple their holdings of Spanish debt, and 22 times the holdings of Irish debt. This number will give you an idea of the enormity of European bank debt. If the euro fails, there will be in a heap of trouble. In gold and silver related news, China holds 8% of US government debt, or one-third held by foreign entities. China's gold demand is seen rising more than 22% in 3 years. The 10-year T-note yielded 3.13%. On the currencies, the yen rose 0.97%. The euro rose 0.62%. The pound rose 1.12 cents. The Swiss franc rose 0.89 cents. And the Canadian dollar fell 0.15 cents. The USDX fell 0.36 cents. Oil fell $1. Gas fell 4 cents. And natural gas fell 6 cents. Copper rose 2 cents. Platinum fell $8.40. And palladium rose $6.65. The CRB fell 1.11. Yesterday, we received the Fed balance sheet, and what a surprise! It hit an all-time record at $2.779 trillion, after adding $24 billion in treasuries. Total reserves also hit a new record, up $53 billion to $1.59 trillion. Foreign holdings fell the most in 4 years by $18.7 billion to $2.685 trillion. The only other time it fell this much was on the 15th of August 2007, down $22.1 billion. That happened in the quant crash. Spot gold rose $13.50 as June rose $13.70. Spot silver rose 54 cents as July rose 60 cents. Today, gold and silver were not to be denied. Gold traded up all morning and was hit about 1 hour before the opening, but it was to no avail. Both metals marched upward all day. Then we saw an explosion of gold. Open interest fell 19,395 to 494,523, which is all about 160,000 contracts below its previous high. Silver open interest fell 2,071 contracts to 120,891, which is near recent lows. The Commitment of Traders report showed commercials in silver reduced shorts by 942 contracts. The gold commercials increased shorts by 10,288 contracts. The problem is, we have no access to the derivative market and what the players are doing there. The HUI rose 8.28 and the XAU rose 3.03. On the shares, Agnico Eagle Mines rose 0.51% or 33 cents. Goldcorp rose 0.08% or 4 cents. Silver Standard Resources rose 1.21% or 35 cents. Mine Finders rose 0.83% or 11 cents. And Pretium Resources rose 1.80% or 17 cents. In addition, it is incredible that for all 2010, only 2 out of 254 trading days rose over 1%. This has been the experience so far in 2011. There was only 1 close above 2% and only 7 above 1%. Normally, this is impossible and can only be due to manipulation. ABC Bullion Sydney have now stopped all their production of 1 kilogram bars of silver. All their silver 1 kilogram bars come from Switzerland. There is a 4-week wait. Perth Mint has stopped all production of 1 kilogram bars due to an extension of the refinery. There is a 3-month wait for 1 kilogram silver bullions. Before signing off today, we would like to thank all of our subscribers for making these broadcasts happen. None of this would have been possible without your continued valuable feedback and support. New listeners are able to follow me on Twitter at Richard J. Wood or the Zed News feed on our Facebook fan page for the latest stories we are following. And to hear my regular radio interviews on the air or online. Also, don't forget to like and also to share these podcasts with your Twitter followers and your Facebook friends. Coming up on the program tomorrow, quantitative easing, recovery not real, and a boiling cauldron of instability that could break loose at any time, raising havoc with the system. Be sure to join us then. I'm Richard Wood, and this has been Zed News. because you can handle the truth.